3, 2, 1, blast!
Back then, to a lot of boomer kids of the 1950s and 60s, the very most exciting thing you could grow up to be was a rocket scientist. Wow.
It just does that to you, you know? It just makes you think, oh my gosh, really got to get involved in this.
From the first time he was at an air show and saw an unusual plane called the Flying Wing, that's what it was, a flying wing, well, he was hooked. Bill Ketchum became part of that white shirt, pocket protector, and slide rule generation of young aeronautical engineers and scientists fresh out of school and into the Cold War.
The attainment of an operational intercontinental ballistic missile at the earliest possible date is a vital concern to the national security.
That missile was the Atlas. They were made here at Kearney Mesa in a huge industrial plant on 252 acres, not much else around Kearney Mesa, in 1958 when General Dynamics Convair Astronautics moved its operations here. And Bill Ketchum was all in, loving life, living his dream in San Diego, designing, building, testing rockets, but...
We were cautioned when we weren't at work to not wear a badge, not let anybody, you know, see, and not talk with anybody about what we were doing in details.
Had to be secret, you know. This was all part of an arms buildup, missiles aimed at the Soviet Union, and something else. October of 1957, the Russians launched the first artificial satellite, Sputnik. The United States was embarrassed.
Why and how did the Russians beat us to the draw?
I felt it tremendously. I think all of us young engineers felt, how on earth could that have happened? All of a sudden it turned toward science and space and, you know, schools, education.
There is a definite shortage of qualified physicists, mathematicians, and chemists. There is a crying need for engineers of all kinds.
Everybody got involved.
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
John Glenn.
Colonel Glenn will pass almost directly over San Diego.
The orbital flights, the moon landings. Bill Ketchum managed the design of propulsion systems right on up to the space shuttle and the International Space Station, right up to the day he retired. Gold watch, goodbye, thank you very much, time to take naps and go fishing, right? No, he's never gotten over the space bug, never. And he's 82 now.
There are times when I wake up in the middle of the night and my mind's conjuring up some new thing to do or work on.
Just now, he's testing a valveless pulse jet engine he's designed and built. Other versions are lined up in his Mission Valley garage, each different from the other in a way that only a rocket scientist could understand. Decades after most would have retired and forgotten everything they learned about engineering physics and rocket mechanics, he's stayed excited.
I'm physically older, but mentally, I think I'm still a kid.
Surrounded by things that nurture the part of him that's still a space-dazzled teenager.
If I were launching a rocket and I needed a part, could I call you? Might you have it in here?
Most likely.
Along with elaborate exhibits he's put together on the history of the space program to inspire new generations at schools and science shows, newspapers that celebrate the triumphs and grieve at the tragedies. And then there's upstairs, his office, a combination aviation and space museum, playroom, and think tank.
This is my man cave, yes.
Right
here. That's
for
sure.
This is it, huh?
There's a sign that says, well, yes, actually I am a rocket scientist. You pick up something and say, what is this?
It's a steering rocket engine on the Atlas.
This is a rocket engine.
Right.
That you have in your house.
Yeah.
It's one of these smaller ones on the side with the flame, see it? Helps to steer the rocket. But there's one thing about Bill, and you maybe guessed it, he personally wants to go into space. And that's where this story takes a turn. Because do you remember the XPRIZE, $10 million to the first non-government someone who could build and fly up 62 miles in a reusable spacecraft and do it again within 2 weeks? Oh, no matter that he was retired, Bill decided he was going to make a space plane.
I built a prototype, a mock-up. There's some photographs here of it.
He calculated thrust, lift, dynamic pressures on the flight surfaces, drew up the plans, made the drawings from every angle, taking into account a zillion factors it would take a rocket scientist to figure out until... Uh-oh.
Bert Rutan, the designer of the first private spaceship, Spaceship One. Bert.
Somebody else won the $10 million. Bert Rutan with his Spaceship One. So did Bill from San Diego give up? No, he went ahead and built a prototype anyway.
The prize had already been won, and so I really just was doing it for my own fun and interest.
Slowly, at a hangar at Montgomery Field, his space plane began to take shape. When the prototype rolled out, there were no champagne celebrations, no toast to the nearly 17 years he worked on it. So now what? He wrote to the Air Museum at March Field in Riverside, asking, would you like it?
Well, the curator of the museum immediately responded and said, yes, we want that.
So today at March Field, on exhibit, there is Bill Ketchum's space plane. Something he did in his retirement, you know, because for all these years, from his youngest days in wide-eyed fascination at planes and rockets, to that time when San Diego's General Dynamics Convair Astronautics was at the center of the space race, and every day since, right up to age 82, he just can't imagine doing anything more exciting. Rocketman!